Netcasts you love.
From people you trust.
This is TWiT. Bandwidth for Triangulation is brought to you by CacheFly at CacheFly.com.
Hi, this is Leo Laporte, and once again, time for TWiT's audience survey. We'd really like to hear from you. It's only going to take a couple of minutes, really. That's all. Just go to twit.tv/survey and let us know what you think. Your anonymous feedback will help us make TWiT even better. And thanks for your continued support.
This is Triangulation, episode 285, recorded Friday, February 3rd, for Monday, February 6th, 2017. Manoush Zomorodi. This episode of Triangulation is brought to you by Hover. Finding the perfect domain name is incredibly easy with Hover. Go to hover.com and use the promo code Triangulation at checkout to save 10% off your first purchase. Welcome to Triangulation. This is the show where we talk to some of the smartest people in technology today. The show is usually hosted by Leo Laporte, but he has allowed me to fill in because I have some favorite people that I like to talk to, and I think that you would enjoy listening to as well. Today, we're talking to Manoush Zomorodi. She is the host of the Note to Self podcast. I've talked to her a few times on Tech News Today and Tech News Tonight, but she has a project that she's doing that I think would really appeal to a wider audience, and I'm really excited to talk to her today. Welcome, Manoush.
Oh, Megan, it's so good to be back. Thank you for having me again.
Thank you. So, yeah, you've done the Bored and Brilliant project, which we talked about, and Taking the Lead, which was about working moms and technology, and you have a book coming out next year.
Yeah, in September, finally. Ugh. It takes forever, but it's based on that project that we talked about, that Bored and Brilliant project, where we got people to put down their phones, to rethink how they use their technology, and see if we could get them to actually be bored on purpose. Which turns out has amazing benefits. So that book is coming out in September.
Awesome. Well, we're going to talk about the privacy paradox, mostly. That's a project that starts today. This show, yes. We're recording a little bit early, but it's coming out today. And as is yours starting today, there's also an intro that you already released that talks a little bit about it. But let's just start. What inspired you to start the Privacy Paradox project?
You know, for me, Megan, it was really two things, right? It was one that we were hearing from our listeners that they were feeling like, you know, I feel like I don't have enough knowledge. I don't know what tools I should be using to protect my personal information. And they were also complaining a lot about just feeling kind of creeped out by ads online. They weren't sure if they should be creeped out or not. And then for me, I just recognized that every time I went to download an app or log into a new platform or something, I'd have that moment when the terms of service would pop up and I'd be like, oh, should I be reading this? Is it okay that I'm giving away all my intimate information? Oh, it's fine. It's fine. Like that moment of ickiness, but then you want to play your game or you want to whatever, find a restaurant around you so you don't have time to deal with privacy issues. And so I just wanted to know, could we spell out for people what they could do? Can we make it feel a little less creepy? And as one expert I spoke to, at least just make it crappy. Because when it's creepy, it means we don't understand it. When it's crappy, we understand it and maybe we feel like we can do something about it.
So creepy versus crappy. I like that.
Yeah, me too.
So that moment of should I download this? I know I probably shouldn't. I loved in your intro, you talked to a behavioral economist who talked about immediate gratification bias. And I loved that term because that is something that I've had this feeling for a long time. Oh, but I love the way that Google Photos automatically tags all my photos and all I can, I can put in dad and it comes up with all the pictures of my father, even the ones from the 70s. And it's amazing. And that immediate gratification, it's so similar to oh, I know that chocolate from the bowl is not going to be good for me, but it's going to make me feel good right now. And the consequences are similar. And I have no idea what Google is doing with my photos. Right. It's probably not as nefarious as a dystopian novel might make it out to be. But at the very least, they're creating a picture of me using those photos, right?
Right. And those behavioral economists that you're talking about, that is what they call this feeling. They call it the privacy paradox, because I think some people think, oh, you know, especially millennials, they don't care about their privacy. And that's just not the truth. Americans actually care very, very much about their privacy. There was a great Pew survey done last year that said 74% of Americans feel very, very strongly that they should be in control of who has their information. And so what these behavioral economists say is, like, we care about our privacy, but then what we actually do doesn't seem to reflect, because there we go, signing away all our personal details and going it to everyone, giving it away to everyone. And we did a survey, actually, with 2,000 of our listeners, and it was interesting. A third of them said that they felt, like, just completely resigned, that this is just the digital age. This is how we live right now. You cannot be a person in the modern world without, you know, how are you going to get a job if you're not on LinkedIn? How are you going to pay your bills? It's just how we live right now. So that's the question, is can we take back a little bit of our control over our personal information and our identity? And as you described, you know, Google Photos, these things are great. They're awesome. They work really well. But how did we get to a point where every day we use all of these tools and we've given away the right to our personal information? And once we've given it away, we can't take it back. And also, frankly, that's what the business model is for a lot of these, right? Like, the reason we can get them for free, the reason why we get all these wonderful new tools, is because we have become what they sell. They take our behavior. This is another expert I spoke to, Shoshana Zuboff, who calls it the surveillance economy. It's not necessarily what we're doing online, like our searches. We don't necessarily, like, yeah, there's some advertising, but it's, what time did we search? How often did we search? What sort of browser are we looking from? They are able to figure out who we are, and they sell our behavior to other companies who want to essentially understand what we want next, predict our behavior. So it is a little dystopian.
Yeah, I really thought, I took my daughter to the Women's March in D.C. and
oh, cool.
It was amazing. And I was getting notifications on my watch from the Women's March app. And, you know, I was there, I was sending text messages, and I couldn't help thinking, even though, you know, it was so inspiring, I couldn't help thinking at this moment, Google and others are gobbling up all this information. They're creating this picture of me. Here's a woman. They probably already know my age, they know my gender. They probably are saying, oh, well, she's here. Here's how she got here. Here's the public transportation that she took to get here. She's coming, you know, from Virginia. They're creating this picture of me, and then they're going to base it on, you know, they're going to use that to sell me certain things. They're probably right. They're probably right that I do want to buy a lot of those things, but it is still creepy.
Yeah. And I think that's the question, is like, Google's, we trust them more or less. They used to say that they weren't evil, right? But what if this technology does go to someone who doesn't have your best interests in mind? A couple things that makes me think about. One is, as you well know, cookies are not the only way that we get tracked these days. It's something called digital fingerprinting. So even if you've decided to opt out, they can figure out who you are based on what browser you're on, what computer you're on, what font you have set up on your computer. They combine all of these, like, dozens of data points to pinpoint exactly who you are and then follow you across the web. There are also other new technologies where literally they are not reading what you write into Facebook necessarily, but what punctuation you use, what words you like to use. They can tell what your personality is, not by what you say, but by reading between the lines. And then the question becomes, well, what if they want you to believe something? What if it's not just about selling you a pair of shoes? What if it's about selling you an idea or a belief, and that idea is not, let's say, in line with our American values, right? And I think that that's where the question turns really to the Fourth Amendment. That is the amendment that gives us our right to privacy. And I think especially, you know, I heard this story last weekend when the ban from Muslim majority immigrants sort of went down, that there was a BBC reporter who was coming into the country on a UK passport, but it's stated that he'd been born in Iran, and he was detained and asked to show his Twitter account. What had he been tweeting? And so I think, you know, maybe 6 months ago we would have said, oh, you know, that's, you know, it sounds like it's kind of scary future, but I don't think we're there. But right now, what is it, 1984, the book is the number one bestseller on Amazon. And so I think our brains are sort of getting to a point where we're starting to see that, yes, the technology is neutral, but when it does get in people's hands who have alternate uses for it, that becomes worrisome that we haven't set up the parameters to begin with.
Absolutely. And something that you said earlier about how it's always there. It doesn't go away. That was mm-hmm. something that I definitely thought about as well, because meanwhile, while I was tweeting about the Women's March, my daughter was Snapchatting just all day about it. And a friend of mine said, when I brought up my concern, they said, you know, what if 20 years from now, she wants to run for office, that they know that she was there. What if we live in a world 20 years from now where they say, look, she went to that protest that, you know, we didn't believe in, that, you know, we don't know what world we're going to live in 20 years from now. She might not be able to, you know, and what if we live in a world where, you know, she wants to run for Republican office at some point, God forbid, just kidding, that they look back and, you know, maybe she'll have different political beliefs at that point, which is totally okay. And they'll look back and that will be there. So, I mean, this stuff, do you talk about the ability to make this stuff disappear?
You know, I think what you're describing to me is so fascinating, because what we're saying is that things that human beings have taken for granted for millennia are being changed by technology. What you're saying is, like, human beings used to forget, and now we don't anymore because we have the computers, and computers never forget. And it's interesting to me that, like, the Europeans, for example, in 2014, the European Court passed the right to be forgotten. That's this idea that you can go to Google and say, I want this link taken off, and they have to consider it. And I just recently checked. It looks like they have removed 780,000 links so far. But it's fascinating to me that they have to consider each one of those cases separately. You can't write an algorithm to make a moral decision to decide whether some information is actually in the public interest and it should stay online, or it's simply something that maybe happened to someone that was terrible and they don't want it out there anymore because we're human, right? And I spoke to Luciano Floridi. He is a philosophy professor at the Oxford Internet Institute, Oxford University. And actually, I found this so interesting, Megan. Google brought him on as an advisor to help them figure out how to deal with this moral ethical issue. And I mean, that's fascinating. First of all, that Google would have an in-house philosopher. That means we're getting into a very interesting chapter when it comes to tech. And then he was saying to me, you know, as he sat down with these engineers, they're like, they never crossed their minds that they would be called upon to make these big moral and ethical choices. When you're an engineer, you know, here's the problem. We fix it. People want information. Here's how we get it to them. And yet, as you're saying, we're going into this uncharted waters where we don't know what's the next thing that we've taken for granted as human beings and tech messes with. Boredom is one thing I've sort of explored, because when we don't have to be bored anymore, it turns out actually for human beings, boredom is a really important thing. Information overload, that was the last project we did too. Humans always wanted more information, but what happens when you have too much of it? And then this time around as well, what happens when you get such wonderful things by sharing your personal information, but then it can come back and bite you in the butt?
So you also...
That's the technical term.
The technical term for the privacy paradox. You also talked to Julia Angwin, who did this great investigative piece about Facebook advertising based on ethnic affinity. Can you talk a little bit about what you learned from her?
She's amazing. I love her. They're right around the corner, actually, here downtown. So what Julia did with her team at ProPublica is they built a tool for the Chrome browser that people could download and then use to see how Facebook was categorizing them. And they had over 50,000 people use the tool and sort of share their information with ProPublica. Is that in the antithesis of privacy. They promised to protect their it was anonymous. And what ProPublica realized was they were able to find over 52,000 different categories that Facebook puts people into, so that, of course, they can say to advertisers, you know, you want someone who loves the color purple, has two kids, and also one category was has pretended to text in public. Like, that's how finally they can parse people. Another one was breastfeeding in public. Pretending to text awkwardly. That was one. That was another one was just grass. Like, I don't know if they meant like this or like walking and barefoot. I don't know. In any case, though, one of the categories was also ethnic affinity, meaning like, I mean, I don't know that this is a specific example, but let's say I liked a lot of hip hop music on Facebook. It would say that I had potentially an ethnic affinity for African Americans. And where you think, well, what's wrong with that? So she gets music that she likes. Here's the problem. That data is very sensitive. So Julia and her team at ProPublica took out an ad on Facebook for an event they were having about housing. And the ad got, Facebook approved it, no problem, in just a few minutes. And they went to a civil rights lawyer who was like, what? I mean, you know, it is illegal. Oh, I should say, they bought this ad and excluded people who had African-American affinity or Hispanic affinity, and I think maybe also Asian-American affinity. And he said, you cannot exclude certain ethnic groups based, whether it's for housing or voting. It's just illegal. It's against U.S. law. And they went back to Facebook, and Facebook was like, yeah, but you weren't selling housing. It was just an event. It's really not that big a deal. But then in the end, people at HUD and in Congress got extremely upset, and they went back to Facebook, who is apparently building a new tool to make sure that this doesn't happen, that certain ethnic affinities don't get left out or don't get shown bank loan advertisements. Because, you know, ads are annoying, but there are some ads that we do want to see, I guess. So, like, we have to make sure that we are still equal opportunity, even as the world goes into our digital civil rights matter just as much as our IRL civil rights.
And the path that happened, the way that happened was, in a way, it was inspiring to me because Facebook is so much of our life right now. And yes, at first they said to ProPublica, you know, that's not true. They had, you know, their PR piece, their person in charge of diversity who said, you know, I want to be served those ads. And then, like you said, they backed up, they changed. And I was struck by the fact that they, mm-hmm. they moved pretty quickly as opposed to the way the government moves. And that does that give you some hope that really that's what we need to do? We have to, you know, look into this, like we have to have people like Julia, people like ProPublica saying this is wrong, making it public and then forcing them to change?
I mean, absolutely. I give ProPublica huge props for doing this. I mean, what makes me sad, and we should say, as far as I know, Facebook's new tool to make sure this doesn't happen has not come out. But I have noticed that there is a new page on Facebook called Tell Zuck, where you can register complaints or problems you have with the site. So it looks as though they are looking for more feedback. But by very virtue of the fact that there is no transparency, that they're not telling people, yes, you can see how you're categorized by Facebook, but they don't share on that page, as far as I understand from Julia, that they also are buying tons of third-party data out there. They are the biggest buyer, from what I understand, from these other, you know, Experian and these other data brokers, so that they can put together a dossier on you and make sure you are targeted. And as we get into, when we're not just talking about ads, but we're talking about fake news or alternative facts or ideas, I think, like, it's not just building a new tool to fix some previous mistake. Let's not get to the mistake to begin with. Let's talk about this more openly, or some of the ideas that we go into in the privacy paradox are even bigger than that. So I went to visit Sir Tim Berners-Lee, the inventor of the web, and he's trying to build something. I don't know if you've heard about this, pods. personal data stores. So the idea being that instead of you logging into Facebook, Facebook would log into you and you would decide what information you do want to share, and you would get to take it back if you decided. Another idea that I'm really interested in is maybe a Hippocratic oath for technologists. I mean, we have them for lawyers and doctors and even sort of journalists. We say truth to power, right? Maybe there should be something that we ask people to make sure that they at least try to keep good in the world and do no harm.
So something beyond just don't be evil.
Yeah, they don't say don't be evil very often anymore.
Yeah, I think they're like, we can do whatever we want.
Kinda. We own the world, essentially. Yeah.
So, and you also talk about having your own sort of privacy statement, your own personal privacy statement. Yes. Can you talk a little bit about that?
Yeah, so we do this actually with Sir Tim Berners-Lee as well. So what we've created for the final day of the challenge, so day five, it's sort of the idea is that it comes together and we've created a personal terms of service. This is like a Mad Lib for your terms of service, so that every time you go to download something new, you don't have to be like, wait, what am I giving away? Is that okay? Is this? No, this is just a rule. So it's like privacy is blank. Whenever I come across blank or blank, I will blank. And we give you a bunch of different suggestions if you need them. But so, for example, for me, I want to have control over my location. I don't want it to be on or off, I've decided. Like the new Uber app update, you can't choose to only share your location when you're using the app. It's either on all the time or completely off. I don't think that's okay. But you know, somebody else might think it is perfectly fine, but what we're asking you to do is figure out where you are on this spectrum, and so that you feel actually every time you go to use technology that you are back in control and that you're not sort of at the mercy of your settings, essentially.
Well, you have a quiz on there. I took the quiz.
You did?
I am a realist.
Me too.
What does that mean? Does that, because some of those questions, yeah, I answered, I was like, well, I'm going to be truthful. Like, I really don't care about that. I probably, yeah, should, but I don't.
Well, you know, and I'm curious if you change after doing the week of challenges. So what we did, I mean, it's super nerdy, Megan, super nerdy. There was a sociologist in the 70s called Alan Weston, and he created really like the fundamental measuring of how Americans felt about privacy. He passed away, I think, a few years back, but we were really inspired by the way that he sort of classified people according to their beliefs about privacy. So we took that inspiration and we turned it into our own fun quiz. And you can be classified as the believer. This is someone, you know, we tried to make it fun. This is someone who loves to watch Mr. Robot, maybe the Americans. They really strongly believe that Fourth Amendment rights are the bottom line. This is someone who takes privacy extremely seriously. Maybe they even have an EFF bumper sticker, just saying. Then there's the realist, right, who understands that in order to get personalization from technology, they do need to give up part of their personal information. That's the way you get personalized, right? You let them know you in certain ways. And they understand that there's the right time and the right place for some of that. And then there's the shrugger, who's just like, whatever, this is how things are going. Who needs privacy? This is where we're going. I mean, I think we'll have a very small number of people who actually choose that, because why would you do this project if you do? But I just think it's fun to sort of check in with yourself. Like, what are my fundamental beliefs about this? Because we're so busy. We don't take time these days to think about the big concepts. And then I get these voicemails. Like, I got one yesterday, Megan, from one of our listeners who, she's like, I wasn't really thinking about this. You know, I'd been listening to the show, privacy, privacy. And then she sat down. She was sort of noticing that she'd been drinking a little too much. She was thinking maybe she should do something about it. She went online and sort of Googled around, like, if she decided to get help, what were her options? And then she logged into Facebook and subsequently got ads for her local liquor store and was, I mean, just the most inhumane, callous. I mean, and the woman was bawling, like left me a message, just crying and being like, she's trying to deal with her problem. And then she gets ads for the local liquor store. It's just, there's a tone deafness to it. And if the technology is going to be part of our everything we do, then we need to bring back a little bit of soul to it, I think.
Yeah. I mean, you have several examples like that. You talk about the woman who was dealing with infertility had just had a miscarriage and saw ads for diapers.
I think you're talking about one woman needed to get her ovaries removed. And so she was doing research on the surgery that she needed to have. And then for months after that was followed around by fertility clinic advertisements, which she was like, I do not appreciate that. Another guy was in a very religious family, and Facebook changed its privacy settings and revealed to his wife that he was actually part of an atheist group. And she subsequently divorced him. It's interesting. I expected to hear like, oh, my husband's social security number got stolen, his identity got stolen. And then other stories where people are like, I don't know, it's creepy, but I'm not sure why. But then there's like these stories in the middle about people's personal privacy lost that are actually fascinating. Things like, marriages and fertility and relationships that are also being affected by these privacy issues, which is kind of, I find it fascinating. And like, that should be that guy's choice if he's gonna talk to his wife about being in the atheist group. And Facebook shouldn't get to decide for him.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it really has gone way beyond the idea. Whenever I hear someone say, well, I'm not doing anything wrong, so why should I be concerned about privacy? It's gone so far beyond that. For sure.
Yeah. Yeah. And I think that's, I hear that all the time too. And I have said it actually. Well, if the government wants to look at my emails, let them. They'll see really boring, passive aggressive emails with my mother-in-law about, about spring break. But I think Bruce Schneier, the cryptographer, makes a really good point. He's actually our day one expert. And he's like, no, you should get on Signal, the encrypted text messaging app, not because you have something to hide, but to show solidarity with people who do have something to hide. Maybe there are people who are concerned that their religion or where they come from will make them suspicious in some way. And so they should be, it's like he says, if everybody uses a postcard, then an envelope becomes suspicious. But if we all use envelopes, then an envelope is just an envelope. And so like we're asking people, let's get on Signal. Let's all just be on Signal. So we just make it normal that we can have private conversations, and not because we have something to hide and not because we're doing something wrong, just because it's American.
Well, we are going to talk about how to get involved in the project, how to sign up for it, and also talk about some of your other projects. But first, I have to take a minute to thank our sponsor. Our sponsor for Triangulation today is Hover. Finding a domain name for your website can be difficult. A lot of them are already taken, but not all of them. So if you have a great idea for a blog or a startup and you want to get a domain name with Hover, it's very easy to set up your domain name, and you can set it up with the most popular website builders out there. They have over 400 domain extensions. They have all the classics. You can get yourself a .com, get yourself a .net. Also niche extensions like .design or .tech. You can also get one of the quirky ones. You can get .pizza, .ninja, or .horse. Once you find your domain, use Hover Connect to set up your domain automatically with your website in just a few clicks. You can also use it to get more on-brand, get yourself a more professional email address. Everyone needs that. Hover only offers domains and email, so you can focus on finding a great domain name and get back to working on your great idea. If all you want to do is buy a domain name and an email address, you shouldn't have to opt out of page after page of add-ons that you don't want or need. And unlike other domain providers, Hover includes free Whois privacy. So we're talking about privacy. That's important, and all supported domains to keep your information confidential. You don't want people to have to just be able to look you up and find out exactly where you live. You don't need that. If you already have a lot of domains scattered across other domain providers, you can save money by bringing them all to Hover with volume discounts. The more domains you have in your account, the more of a discount Hover will automatically apply to your account. With Hover, there's no more digging through help articles to figure out how to get your domain working. If you need a hand, give them a call, and Hover's awesome support team is there to help you. Find the perfect domain name for your idea. Go to hover.com. Use the promo code Triangulation. Let them know we sent you there. Use that at checkout to get 10% off your first purchase. That's hover.com. Use the promo code Triangulation, and we thank Hover for their support of Triangulation. I am talking to Manoush Zomorodi. She's host of Note to Self, the Note to Self podcast, and she has created the Privacy Paradox project that we've been talking about. How do people get involved with the project? How do they sign up?
It's pretty easy. So you go to privacyparadox.org. You're going to see a big button in the middle. Put in your email. We will not share your email with anyone. We also have a plain, a simple, and an easy to understand privacy statement of our own, if you're curious about that. Yeah, there it is. And what happens is you're going to trigger a newsletter that you're going to get. And this newsletter, for 1 week, you're going to get every day a newsletter with tips, articles, more about the science and technology behind that day's challenge. And so with that day's challenge, we're asking you to just try a little behavior tweak. Try a tool. See how it inspires you, maybe makes you think differently, maybe not. This is an experiment. And then also each day you get a mini podcast with one of our experts. So the founder or inventor of the World Wide Web, for example, Bruce Schneier, the cryptographer. We even have the executive producer of The Bachelor. Megan, he has some interesting things to say about how people's behavior changes when they know they're being watched. So we are really trying to hit this from all angles and find the one that speaks to you and see if by the end of the week you feel as though you can take back a little control over your personal information and your identity. So yeah, there are the challenges. You can hear our first episode, which sort of lays out how we got to this place, to a web where our behavior is tracked, compiled, and sold. And then every day we sort of go into a different angle. One of my other favorite days is day 4, which is also the psychological implications of living without any privacy. We talked to a Stanford University psychiatrist who sees a lot. He has does his own research and also sees undergrads who this he talked about something called differentiation, which is all kinds of psychologists have talked about this idea that you need to have alone time in order to become a fully formed human adult. And so if you're spitting out opinions or talking through things all the time, he's seeing regressive behavior. Some would say we're also seeing other regressive behavior from certain adults running the country on other social media platforms, but I won't get into that.
Some people do say that for sure. Yes, yeah, so this is so interesting with our kids. I think about it a lot in terms of, you know, find my friends with your children. What are the ethics of that? You know, you can know where your children are at all times if they have an iPhone, and that might make you feel more comfortable in the present. But what are you teaching them? You're teaching them to just be comfortable with the fact that Big Brother is always spying on them.
Yeah, I mean, I think that that is very tricky. And it's almost like, I mean, here's the other paradox, right? To talk about, to do something about privacy, we have to have a very public conversation about what is okay. And there's another person I spoke to, Professor Joseph Turo. He has a great new book out called The Aisles Have Eyes. And he talks about how online shopping has really conditioned all of us to think that it's okay that we're constantly being tracked. Like, I didn't know this, Megan, but Retail Genius, do you know about this? Like, the minute you walk into a store, Bluetooth and wireless, they can tell the people, the owners of the store, how much money you make, how much money you're likely to spend while you visit, whether you are likely to actually buy something at all. And so they can even tell customer, you know, people who work in the store, like, well, don't bother helping that person because they're just going to look and they're not going to buy anything, which is, I mean, you start to wonder at what point does it become discriminatory? When you know too much, what gets held against you? So, I mean, I'm a little early to the kid thing. My son is 9 and he just asked me for an email account. So... I was like, I don't know. I might get him a Rise Up account. What do you think about that?
I don't even know what that is. What's a Rise Up account?
Well, it's like, it's another, I mean, it's one of these small boutique email places where they are not funded by the big tech companies and they encrypt absolutely everything. Because I just feel like, well, this is him. He's going to, we never post anything about my kids, but this is like his first foray into being tracked for the rest of his life online. And isn't it my duty as a parent to give him a clean, as much of a clean slate before he goes to make his own decisions at the age of 18? On the other hand, you know, you buy into these small companies that promise to protect your privacy. What happens if they go out of business? Or what happens if there's something wrong with your account and they just don't have the staffing or the funds to give you the service that Gmail does for free?
Mm-hmm. Well, one of the things about speaking of kids and teenagers that I have found fascinating is that, you know, only the adults are on Facebook, right? And there are some kids on Instagram. But the rise of Snapchat, I really think, has a lot to do with a whole generation of kids who are now a little bit older saying, I don't want my life. I don't want all the photos I've ever taken to be on Facebook. I don't want everything to stick around. I think a lot of people said the rise of Snapchat was all about sexting and, you know, sending, you know, right, photos that you wanted to disappear because you didn't want your parents to see them because you were doing something wrong. But I think it's just really kids saying, like, I don't want that, saying no to that. And I don't know if, I mean, and is that real? Because that stuff on Snapchat is still somewhere. It doesn't disappear.
Right. I mean, right. So there are like two questions there. One is, it makes me think, like, is there something sort of evolutionary about wanting to hold on to privacy? One of the behavioral economists that I spoke to at Carnegie Mellon is like doing research into that. Like, what are the sort of primitive, primal reasons why humans do seek out privacy? So that's interesting to me that, like, if these kids are gravitating towards it, I'm curious that by the time, like, my kid's a teenager, is it going to be a thing, like, on the weekends, it is totally not cool to be on your phone on Saturdays and Sundays? Like, I wonder, you know? But then it comes, and then there's your other thing with Snapchat, which is, what was your other thing, Megan? Which is like, are they being conditioned by the technology itself, is what I wonder, mm-hmm. you know? That you get points, from what I understand, I'm an old person, so I don't totally know, but I think you get points and you keep a streak going mm-hmm. and all those things that we talked about. So you're rewarded by the platform for staying on it as well. And of course, like you said, like, it takes 2 seconds to do a screen grab of something and then it does live forever.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, the streaks, they're really capitalizing on children's friendships on that way, because, you know, the kids do, like, oh, we have a 126-day streak. And it's true. I mean, the kids that I know will turn over their password to other people if their phone gets taken away. Or, you know, if I say we're not going to have the phone for the week, okay, well, I'm going to give my friend my password so she can Snapchat herself from my account so that we keep our streak. So it's an invitation to sharing our passwords, which we know is not a good idea.
Right. I mean, it also means, like, as parents, we have to have the weirdest conversations. Like, so why do you want to have a streak? Mm-hmm. What sort of validation, or maybe not, don't use the word validation, but like, what does that make you feel like? Why mm-hmm. do you think it makes you feel that way? Like, we have to have the weirdest conversations about the emotions that are very innate driving us towards using these things more. Like, back to that Stanford university psychiatrist I was talking to, is he was talking about he's written a book, I think, called The Virtual You, the E-Personality, and this idea of, like, how much being online brings out the impulsive nature of us, in part, you know, for lots of reasons, and he goes through them in his book, but I think, like, it's almost like you have to say, like in the 80s, maybe, like, smoking, like, people wouldn't give up smoking, they thought it was cool, until you told them, like, well, you know that you're being totally played by the cigarette companies, right? Like, that was when people were like, oh, they can't make me do something. Like, I think we have to almost look at it, like, look underneath the hood and be like, why it's designed. Here's why they put that button there. Here's, you know, when you go shopping, here's what the back end looks like, right? Because otherwise, we don't take the time to even think about how, like, who the people are who made the stuff. They just, like, Snapchat just exists on your phone, and it's wonderful. And I don't want to sound like a fuddy-duddy when I say this, because I use all this stuff too, other than Snapchat. I'm on all of it, you know. I do love it, but I also see how, like, late at night, I know all this, and I still have a hard time putting down my phone. So I can only imagine how difficult it must be for other people who are similarly neurotic like me and don't spend all day thinking about this.
Exactly. Well, I have one more question about privacy, and that is, when you were talking about Bruce Schneier said everyone should be on Signal, it should just be the normal thing to do.
Yeah.
And I mean, because that's the key. If your friends aren't on the encrypted messaging tool that you are on, you're not going to be able to chat with them. Do you think that we do have a moral responsibility or societal responsibility to care more about our privacy for everyone, for people that might not be doing anything wrong, for someone that might be marginalized? Do you think that we all have a responsibility to respect our own privacy for all of us as a whole?
Yeah, and actually Bruce uses that exact word, that as we look to make sure that we are standing up for marginalized populations in this country, that means that we have to stand up for privacy, because we are a country that has said there's the Fourth Amendment, which is you cannot just decide to criminalize someone without probable cause. I didn't know this, Megan, but did you know that that law enforcement regularly uses search terms to bring criminal charges against individuals? That was kind of shocking to me. The fact that none of this is, there's very little laws on the books about what the government can and can't do when it comes to our digital civil rights. They do need a warrant to search a cell phone, but for example, last month, or in December, law enforcement asked Amazon for whatever an Echo had recorded in the home of an alleged murderer. I don't think Amazon complied, but it just goes to show every time there's a new technology, the line gets pushed further, and we're at a point where it's going to be this next sort of Supreme Court couple years. I think it's going to be very interesting to see where legally the line starts to get drawn.
Mm-hmm. I spoke to a few weeks ago, I spoke to Scott Hanselman. He's a programmer at Microsoft and a big proponent of diversity. And he used a phrase, lending your privilege, which I really liked. And I think that fits here, because it really is like, okay, I haven't really done anything wrong. I have no reason to protect my privacy, but I maybe should just protect it so that, like you said, if we all use envelopes instead of postcards, then envelopes become the thing.
And it's like, that's how the Pony Express came to be, that, you know, and I remember as a kid, you would never open like your neighbor's mailbox. Like it was just like, that was just a, like you, I don't know. There was, it was like enshrined that was private and you weren't allowed to touch it. And we just all knew that. So we start to have to put cultural norms around the rest of this too. But the question is like, okay, so a letter inside an envelope, that's private. It's very clear. But if you write an email, well, I don't know, does that fall actually under the third party doctrine, which says that once you hand your information over to a private company, you don't have control over it anymore? Or is a letter that you write in Gmail just the same as a letter as you would have written on paper? Like, these are like weird, tricky discussions that need to be had, and they need to be had pretty soon because we're in a political climate where anything could happen. And when you don't have rules and laws and codified cultural norms around these things, they can shift extremely quickly, as we have seen in the last couple weeks.
Mm-hmm. Well, Note to Self is a lot about privacy, but a lot of different tech topics, life's digital quandaries is what you call them. And so I highly recommend if anyone is interested. And I'm just interested, how did you, what inspired you to start this podcast?
You know, it started in the weirdest way. It was 3 years ago, and I was sort of saying to the people at the station, like, you need to be covering more of the tech economy in New York. And so really, I started more as like a tech business sort of local show. But, you know, as you know, there's a lot of people covering the tech industry. And really what I found was that people related more to me when I talked about the more sociological elements of technology, how tech was changing the way we parent, where we work, how we get to work, if we even go to work anymore. And that when I told the more personal stories about it, the more sort of individual choices we were making, that was what, you know, and podcasting is a very intimate medium. So I think it was a good fit to talk about those things. And I mean, I'm on this journey too, you know, I was not a big tech head or anything like I like my technology a lot, but I'm not, I don't code. And so I felt like this was something that I could talk to my listeners about and we could try and figure it out together. And so with these projects, it's been great because tens of thousands of people have done them and they've given their feedback. So we really are creating our own sort of research lab in a way. And we have had a lot of researchers come to us to ask us what we've learned from these projects because, I mean, the tech is racing ahead far faster than they can put out papers talking about how much screen time is right for, you know, 2-year-olds. So we're sort of, I feel like there's this grand experiment happening. We're at this incredible moment in history where things could go so many different ways. And so let's take this opportunity to talk about what we want going forward as human beings, not just be like, so cool, let's upgrade, you know, like we're past that. It is cool. It's wonderful. But now we have to figure out how we use it the right way.
Yeah. And we can't just live in a state of anxiety about it, too. I mean, I'm thinking in particular about parents, but I mean, I think it's general, especially when you're talking about privacy or how much time you spend as an adult on your phone or on Facebook, just to think, oh, I know this is horrible and I'm going to do it anyway. But you really look into why are you doing it and how can you back up and what that can do for you.
Yeah, for sure. And I think, you know, it doesn't have to be a bummer to get off your phone. So, for example, with Bored and Brilliant, what I sort of was noticing that I was never bored anymore. Like every time I was waiting for coffee or waiting for the subway, I had my phone, of course. And so I sort of, because this is what I can do for my listeners, is I can go find out, well, actually, what happens when we get bored? And it turns out when we're bored, we activate this network in our brain called the default mode. And it's a really important network. It's where we do our most original thinking and problem solving and something called autobiographical planning, which is where you set the goals for your life and you figure out how to get to them. Like, that's pretty important stuff. So instead of like, oh, I'm so bored. No, I'm so bored. Yeah, it's a little uncomfortable at first, but actually you can get to some amazing places in your mind. And to have teenagers say to me, like, I had never had this sensation before. Like, they'd never been bored. Like, well, okay, so that just means that we have to teach different stuff. We don't have to teach them necessarily how to use a computer, but we do have to teach them that this feeling of being bored is actually what it feels like when your brain is doing very hard work and it takes time. So it's almost like we're learning now how our curriculums almost have to change. And I've heard that from a lot of educators, school librarians and computer science teachers saying, looking for different resources that they're like, I can't just teach them how, you know, what Java is. Like, I have to teach them also life skills around this stuff.
Mm-hmm. And the ethics, as you said before, really, the ethics of it, you know, if we are raising, you know, if STEM is so important and coding is so important, it should be just as important to talk about the ethics behind all that as well.
Yeah. And that was, you know, Anil Dash, a technologist who sort of had a moment where he realized that some of the stuff he was making was causing harm in people's lives, talks about that there are no computer science programs that have a required ethics class, is what he told me. And so that seems like a really easy thing that we could do. Like I'm not saying, you know, pass laws necessarily, although I do think there should be some, but like, let's at least have a conversation about it.
Yes. Well, Bored and Brilliant, the book comes out in the fall.
Yes.
Excellent.
September. Yes. I'm looking forward to it.
There was a piece, a profile on the show and on you in the New York Times that I just reread. And there was a part where you talk about how your husband plays a game with your kids where he pretends he's George Washington and they have to they have to tell him what modern life is like. And I just thought, like, there is no app for that kind of interaction. That just is. Do they still do that or have they grown out of that?
They still do that. What I like about that game is that means that they have to be like, so this George Washington, this is a water bottle. It is made of metals. Take it. Like, they have to think through, like, what actually is it? What is it made of? Where did it come from? Like, so I think it's actually a good little exercise. But the latest thing is my daughter, who's six, is pretending to be the chief of the Supreme Court, John Roberts. It's a new, leave it to my husband, the politics reporter. He can take all the credit for that.
Well, Manoush, thank you so much for your time. I really appreciate it. Privacyparadox.org. Go check it out. Go sign up. It starts today. And if you miss Bored and Brilliant or Info Magical, the boot camp, those are still available as well. Subscribe to Note to Self. It is an excellent podcast. You can listen to our podcast and her podcast. They can go nicely together, I think.
Synergy. I love it, Megan.
Thank you so much. At Note to Self on Twitter or Manoush Z on Twitter. Thanks so much for coming on.
Oh, Megan, it's always a pleasure talking to you. So fun.
All right. Take care.
Bye. Thank you.
Thank you. And super thank you. Fun. Thank you for joining us on Triangulation. We record every Monday at 11 a.m. Pacific. You can check that out at twit.tv/try, and you can subscribe to the podcast there. And check out our survey. We want to see what you think of our shows. If we learn more about you, then we can deliver content and advertising that's better suited to you, and we protect your privacy also. And I am Megan Morrone on Twitter. You can contact me, Megan, at twit.tv, and Leo will be back as usual on Triangulation. Thanks so much for joining us.